know in order to be able to win. Basically, with rooks, there is, you can no longer make such kind of positions in Zugzwang, because you can always move somewhere. And it's in general much harder to advance with the pawn. In most cases, if you play with the king on the pawn, you will get to position like this. That's basically the maximum you can get. You can try to push your pawn. Let's assume position was like this. You go king g6. I basically cannot do anything. So you can push your pawn. Mechanism for you to advance is very simple. You cut off the king, so my king does not come here. And then you move your king to the side. In this case you go to the side because pawn is hanging. If rook would be on h1, you would go king g7 because pawn was not hanging. And basically you slowly improve. Like, depending on where my rook is, I cannot stop you at all. But now, after king comes to g8, where is the trick? Because basically, you can no longer escape with your king. You want to make a queen. And my king blocks you, my rook blocks you. So what should you do? Yes, you can check, but then I just stay. You don't really achieve anything by this check. Black rook should be on h5, because otherwise, if rook would be here, for example, you just go rook h2, securing your spot for your king, and then you go king h8 and g8 queen. With king f7, you go rook h7, and g8 queen. So you just win the game. But for this reason, black have to stay on h5, king should be stayed here to block my king. Mechanism to win is very simple, you just give a check. My king goes away. Now it looks like you can just escape with your king. But it's actually not working, because I simply go into check. You cannot escape, because otherwise I just take the pawn.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to go back, and then you'll be keep checking and attacking the g-pawn. So the only best thing you can do is to return back to h1, to g8. And basically, what you should do in this position is try to prepare against these checks. Because again, black have no ideas, we can just try to block you from going out. So king has to be here, rook has to be on h. And basically, when you go out, you cannot help, your rook does not help you, because black just check. For this reason, you make such move. I think this idea is called a bridge. You're trying to make to build a bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, you put rook to e4. So now, after your king goes away, and I check, at some moment, my king goes to g5, and now my rook is close enough. So I block your rook.
Mm-hmm.
And this king is too far away from g4. Mm-hmm. So I just make a queen. This is a very essential position for many games, because basically, if you understand that your pawn can come to such far, you will win all the time. It works with any pawn but h-pawn. With h-pawn is different because there is no line here,
mm-hmm.
and it's just completely, it's completely different mechanism. We will discuss it later.
Mm-hmm.
It's much more complicated. So, for this pawn, black king should be at least. But the least you should cut him off in order to win.
A check doesn't block.
Yeah, because now you should go like this, and also it's mm-hmm. much more complicated.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. For example, like why this position with king on g8 pawn g7 is very important. It's basically the same for all pawns. Assume you have position like this. It's white to me. And it's not so simple to... Like this. And it's not simple for you to figure out what to do. It's not simple for you to understand if you're going to win or not. First thing you should do is to cut. Joshua, in general, I would recommend you to avoid doing checks if you don't understand why you do it. So this is quite a common mistake for young chess players, because you know that when you check your take the king, you know that you're not going to lose anything. You just make a check, and in fact, check makes your position worse.
So
it is just a bet.
I see. Okay.
It's the most common mistake in any games. King h4 is fine, but you first need to cut my king, so I will not come to the pawn. How can you do that?
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. You cut my king. Try to cut king h7. What do you know? Exactly. I cannot go to h6 because you just take. And now we got to the winning pawn endgame because your king is in front of the pawn. And you win because of that position. And so on. So I cannot do anything, and basically I'm not able to stop your pawn. So the very best thing to do is just to go away, and you slowly improve. And so on. Depending on what I do. Again, there is no option to stop. Why it's important to cut off the king? If my king will be here, even if position is like this, there is no idea for white. You just cannot improve. I just stay. My rook captures. 8th rank. You can check. You cannot achieve anything. If you go g7, I check, you'd actually win because you miss it. So this happens only with h and g pawns. Like if pawn is on f file, it's different. Now you cannot defend like this. Not defend the piece because now you have extra line, so you can go rook h7. You are threatening to mate, and now after king g8, you simply check. There is same idea, but I cannot no longer check because I check, and you easily win. In general, like this is winning only if pawn is very far away, and this is called passive defense, it's just not working. Usually, if king is in front of the pawn, no matter which pawn it is, see, and pawn is not advanced till the end, like I just showed, it's usually going to be a draw, because there are several theoretical positions. The very simple one, I showed you just the very simple one, because others are more complicated, I think it's just not needed for your level at the moment. Doesn't matter where a king is, you just put your king to f8. You put it in front of the pawn. When the king advances, when the pawn comes to the 5th rank, you do a very simple thing. You put your rook to the 6th rank. So you cut off the king, you cut off the pawn. There is no idea for white. You don't move the king, you move only the rook. You just play with the rook. King is perfect on the plate. Then, if white tries to exchange, it doesn't work because pawn and game is there. So there is no idea for white. If white moves rook from the 7th rank, you just go close. Again, there is no idea for white. And basically, the only move white can do is to go f6. After f6, king cannot escape from checks. So you can go rook a1. This was basically our trick. We've forced white to push f6, now king g6, threatening to mate. You just check. Check, 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 and game is at hand. It was necessary because that's a quite common way to escape from check. If rook comes here, immediately. But you might think, if king comes to f6, I just check him. So he has to go away. And if king comes here, I just check him there. But that's not working because it comes here first, and after check it comes here.
Yeah.
You can no longer check from a6. So for this reason, you need to cut it off first. And basically, like for this reason, white usually try to cut off the king. For example, assume position is something like this. How would you play? But you're not, you don't cut off my king. I've just come cold.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Russia, it's not hurting. Russia, you need to cut off my king.
Off, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I don't come closer. It's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, exactly. You just cut off king from coming to the pawn. Now position is winning, but it's also not so obvious. As you can see, it's not so simple. Because my rook takes the pawn, even if I had come closer, I always check. In general, it's considered that rook is better from behind the pawn, no matter which pawn it is. But if it's your pawn, it's still better from behind, because it helps to push the pawn. If it's opponent pawn, it's still better from behind, because your opponent's rook cannot help. In this case, because king is cut off, the only chance for black is basically to block the pawn and prevent king from advancing by doing checks. There are many things to make it work. Like, first of all, king usually should not be cut off for more than one line. Now it's two lines. Depends on the pawn also. Like, west four pawns basically are winning. G pawn is a draw, but it's very complicated. Not discussed right now. In general, what I recommend you to put attention. Such ideas as check. Actually, when we check from the side, it's also exactly the same. There should be three empty fields in between the pawn and rook. Or you might say that rook and pawn should be like five, we should capture five fields. But the only way how you can make it work. Because if pawn is here, king just comes close. You can no longer check because king comes, there is no space to check. If there is at least three fields in between, then you can do that. In this case, position is winning because white can still improve by go king h6. F5, I just want to push my king as far as I can. And after rook f8, you go rook f3. At the moment, king, we let him come close. But our point was to push the pawn as fast as we can. So he goes away, f5, 7, king g7, and again, we just achieved our goal. Like in this case, king still was not in time to go to f8. So it's a more complicated example, but in general mechanism is the same. There are different situations where we do checks. For example, with quite common theoretical position, basically, I assume somewhere here, black try to check, and again there are three fields in between, so you can just do checks. We know that if we have at least three fields in between, you can just check and your opponent cannot come closer to you because you will simply take the pawn. So there is basically no way to improve for white. And again, if we have only two fields in between, then we cannot really, usually we cannot really check because king just comes and attacks our rook. Sometimes there are actually very interesting ideas because of this. For example, it was one game, I think it was Poet by Tal against someone.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, I think it was something like this. Black wanted to go to get this position. This is theoretical draw. This was where I go. But they did one inaccuracy. I think king was here and rook was somewhere here. Maybe white was not advanced enough. And basically what happened, white played rook e8
mm-hmm.
to capture the 8 rank. So if rook comes like this, there is no longer this space. There is only two fields in between.
Mm-hmm.
So now king comes and that's how white won.
Mm-hmm.
I would not say that such defensive mechanism happens often. I would say it's more rarely than often. And first of all, what you should know how to do is how to cut off the king, advance with your king to the final rank, and then build the bridge by doing what I showed.
Mm-hmm.
This is very important because that's basically how almost every looking game ends if you are going to win. And it just helps you to easily evaluate rook end game or transpose to the rook end game. Now I will show you just several examples. I think you probably have them in Capablanca's book.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I will just show you briefly because you already started it.
He finished the example one.
Okay.
Like a one lock, one king. Forces one king, mm-hmm. you know, on the side, I think.
Yeah,
Joshua,
in general, in the end game, I will just show you simple examples. But if you have more material, you're going to win. That's what usually happens in chess. If you have extra pawn, you'll be able to win in most of the cases. For example, let's assume you have end game like this. Much more often than just a pure pawn in the game. So what's the difference for adding those pawns? What do you think? Is it good for white or not?
Good.
Yes, it's good. Now white are... Switch it out. Now white are completely winning. Because we are no longer... binded to this side of the board.
Mm-hmm.
Now if this would be just pawn in game with one pawn, you would simply can agree to a draw at some moment because I think position is like this. You cannot really improve because like what we discussed. You remember? But basically the only thing you can do is stalemate, right? In this case, situation is different. We don't need to advance our pawn on b5. There are more material here. Because of this, mechanism to win is extremely simple. You compose with your king, you advance your pawn, you advance your pawn, you advance your pawn, and then at some moment, you use this pawn as a distraction for your opponent's king, and you just come to take less pawns. And that's basically how, in most cases, you win in pawn end games. Now king is very far away, so you just take all the pawns, now have absolutely winning position with three pressed pawns.
Oh, you know, could we use here just for promotion one king?
Again, that's the point. That's the point because here you cannot promote it. Like if we take the pawns away,
mm-hmm.
it would be a draw.
Mm-hmm.
But because we add extra material,
mm-hmm.
it's winning.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't necessarily need to promote the pawn
mm-hmm.
on one side. You can use this pawn as distraction.
Mm-hmm.
That's very common.
Okay, I see. Okay. Yeah.
And. For example, in some cases, You don't necessarily need to have equal material here.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if I put position like this,
somewhere
most likely it's still going to be lost
mm-hmm.
for black. Now, probably some precision is required. Okay. Now it's definitely lost. Because basically your idea is the same. You use this pawn with destruction. Also, but after you push a5, you don't even have to go king c5. You might just wait for some time.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, what you can do, you can wait for black to advance pawns a little bit, so that you make a weakness. For example, you can try to block. Assume you have pawns like this. You're not sure if you win again after king c5. You might wait for him to put pawns like this. And then someone you go and take over. Now every position would be different because you would need to calculate if you're going in time. But in general, it's considered to be winning because your king is just two steps closer to the pawns,
mm-hmm.
and even though there are more pawns, you start taking them earlier.
Mm-hmm.
There are even some famous compositions. This is one of them. Basically, bless you. When kings come closer,
sure, yeah. So there are poker tells you like just promote.
What?
Set a book.
Yes.
Tell you promote.
Yes, but
yeah.
I mean, as I showed in our first lesson, like sometimes you can promote, sometimes you cannot promote.
Okay. Okay.
So that's
yeah.
So it depends.
Yeah.
I just wanted to show you that you don't necessarily promote. You
yeah.
also use it as distraction,
yeah.
and that's
but
where
in,
you come.
But on that side, we have equal pawns, right? We will try to promote on this side.
Mm-hmm.
If we have less, let me see. You know. go ahead. You can. I don't want to interrupt you. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Basically, in most cases, calculation is very simple in pawn endgame. If your king is closer to the pawns, usually you are going to win because you are the first one who takes them.
Mm-hmm.
Then you end up winning. This is very famous
mm-hmm.
Composition.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, now kings are going at the same time. So I mean, if I go to the B file,
mm-hmm.
you also go to the B file.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not ahead. And now it's actually very. I think it's actually was like this.
Treasure, you listen.
Okay. It was like this. We get to such very funny way of opposition. Because as king comes closer, my goal is to take the pawns, but don't let you take my pawn on g5. Basically,